Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Matthew LaClair, and this is Equal Time for Freethought. On this program, we promote humanism, which is founded on rationality, critical thinking, and scientific naturalism, as we explore ways to create positive social change. In studio today is our guest, Neil deGrasse Tyson. He is an astrophysicist and director at the Frederick P. Rose Hayden Planetarium at the Museum of Natural History in New York City. He has hosted Nova Science Now on PBS and will be hosting Cosmos, based on the original with Carl Sagan, on Fox. Appearing numerous times on The Daily Show, The Colbert Report, Real Time with Bill Maher, and more, he is considered to be one of the most effective science communicators of our time. He has written a number of books, including his most recent, Space Chronicles, Facing the Ultimate Frontier. There is much more I can say about Dr. Tyson, including his honors, including one of Time Magazine's most influential people, and of course, we can't forget People Magazine's sexiest astrophysicist alive. But I think we'll stop there and we'll get to talking. So welcome to the show, Dr. Tyson.
Matthew LaClair, you're all grown up. My God, look at you.
I am. It's
like
been...
you got a beard and that, like a little bit of little something happening there on your chin.
It's been a couple of years, I know. Dr. Tyson and I first met, I think it was 2007.
Around there, yeah.
In Lower Manhattan, just probably a few blocks from here is what I'm thinking. I was giving a speech one of those nights for my actions in Kearny, New Jersey against my proselytizing teacher, and I got to have some
your
interesting
transgressions.
which have been, I guess, 6 years ago now. So it's been quite a while, and good to see you again. This time I get to interview you, and it's a
I'm happy to be here just for you.
All right. So I guess I'm just going to start with a basic question about how you began in your field, and you've become such a popular figure. Just tell us a little bit about how you became first interested in your field of astrophysics and science more broadly, and when did you feel like your career really started to take off?
Oh, well, I don't think of anything going on as a career taking off, anything that's happening in my life just now. I'll tell you why in a minute, but I've known since I was 9 years old that the universe was for me. And in fact, it was from a first visit to the Hayden Planetarium, where I'm now director. I was a kid, family trip. Lights turned out, stars came out, and I was hooked. I was hooked in a way that I'm pretty sure I had nothing to do with it. I think the universe called me. It was not I who called it. And it would take a couple of years before I'd figure out that you can make a career out of this, because as a kid, it's just something fun to do or fun to think about, fun to look at pictures of. And by age 11, I knew. If you were the adult asking that annoying question that adults always ask kids, what do you want to be when you grow up? By age 11, I knew astrophysics. So I've known my whole life, and most of my decisions related to steps that I took, things I majored in, courses I would take, all fed this interest. And so the universe runs deep within me, as it does in all of us. It just has to be awakened.
Yeah, and that's something that I think you've been clearly working on, particularly recently regarding NASA trying to get a little bit more money for its budget from the United States government. And I'm sure we'll spend a good amount of talking about that today.
Sure.
Particularly because we're at a point now where, you know, obviously money is starting to become a major issue in the United States and around the world. And I understand that right now, as it is, it's something like half of 1%.
Yes, it fluctuates right now between 0.4 and 0.5. Not more than one half of 1% of your tax dollar goes to fund NASA.
So I guess I'll ask that annoying question. A lot of people will say, well, don't we have enough troubles here? What do we do here? So I'd like you to tell us just, number one, what percentage of the national budget do you think would be appropriate for NASA to have? And number two, why is NASA so important aside from its involvement in trying to understand and explore space?
Well, first, I'd pick a number. I mean, the number is a little bit arbitrary. I picked a clean factor of two. I could say factor of four, but I'll stop at a factor of two. I don't want to be too greedy.
Although it would be very, very interesting to see what we could do with all that money. But
so a factor of two would take the one half of a percent on the tax dollar to 1%. And that would be enough to get NASA back on the space frontier in a big way soon, rather than in a little way sometime in the not designated future. So that would be enough, definitely be enough, to not only do everything we all had NASA, all the tasks that we hold NASA responsible for conducting, including Earth monitoring. There's a lot of non-space frontier things that NASA is charged with accomplishing. There's a whole division of NASA that's based in aeronautics, for example. That's what one of the A's stands for in NASA.
Right.
We don't normally think of that as a NASA activity, but it is by charter. So I think a healthy NASA is a NASA that is expanding a space frontier, not sustaining a frontier that has already been earned. And over the shuttle era, while the construction of the space station was a remarkable engineering feat to build something the size of a football field in zero G, it's an extraordinary act. And it's fine, but while it expanded an engineering frontier, it did not expand a space frontier, which I define simply as, are you farther away from Earth today than you were yesterday? All right? And that's a simple way to think about expanding a frontier. That's what any definition of frontier meant in the history of cultures, right? The frontier is where beyond which no one had gone before. That's a very simple definition. So I'm curious why it is that NASA is always contrasted with social problems on Earth. Why are we spending money up there when we should be spending money down here? I'm curious about that. And anyone who utters that sentence, I have come to learn, does not know how much money we're spending up there, nor do they actually know how much money we're spending down here. Because when I tell them we're spending 0.5% on your tax dollar, it's, oh, I didn't know it was that little. I thought it was 5% or 10%. They think it's some huge fraction.
Really?
But it's not. So then I ask them, what do you think we're spending down here? Again, it's a little bit of research hardly anyone does. But I did. All right?
Google.
You add up all of the social programs and education, money the U.S. government spends on social programs and education, it is 50 times what we spend on NASA. So we are spending money down here. So the entire construct of the question has no foundation, because you thought NASA was getting more, and you thought down here was not getting enough. And you contrast the two, there's no other way to interpret it, but yeah, we are, the government does care about what's going on down here. So the question then is, even at 1%, what is the value that that brings to America? And apart from establishing dreams, it engages our capacity to dream about a future that science and technology would bring. That's what the 1960s was all about. The World's Fair in Flushing Meadow, New York, was all about tomorrow, a tomorrow that was brought to you by science and technology. And that World's Fair did not create the 60s. That World's Fair came out of a culture of discovery and exploration, which was shaped by our journey to the moon. There's no other way to slice that. So the capacity to dream, I think, NASA is a force operating on that urge, a force like none other that exists in society. So that's an important piece of this. But maybe you don't want to dream. Maybe you don't care about dreaming. And I'll respect that. I don't want to respect it, but I will, because we're in a free society.
Right.
Think how you like. But understand the consequences of it. When you advance a frontier, you innovate. And when you innovate, you invent things, you patent things, you discover things that show up as commercial product, that show up as things that improve life, that show up as entire new branches of economics that show up in your society. So the economies of tomorrow, in the 21st century, will flow out of the innovations in science and technology we make today. Other countries know that. Apparently, we don't.
So what kinds of results have we received from NASA's exploration, from NASA's attempts to try and understand more about the universe directly here on Earth?
Well, apart from just scientific discovery, which certainly titillates scientists and not necessarily other people, some like to make the argument about space spinoffs, which I don't make. I make it just as a point of information, not as an argument. There are extraordinary spinoffs that have come from NASA. For example, the capacity of the space shuttle to dock with the space station that uses sort of a laser alignment technique that was directly co-opted into LASIK surgery, so that now LASIK surgery can be conducted inexpensively and with precision in ways that were not previously possible were it not for that activity of NASA. Right? That's just as an example. So I could give the list. The miniaturization of electronics to begin with was the consequence of NASA's urge to reduce the weight of payloads going into space, because every ounce that doesn't need to be there costs you in fuel. There's something called the rocket equation, which tells you how much extra fuel you need just to launch the fuel you haven't burned yet, which has to be there to launch the extra ounce that you left on the craft. And where were the astronauts? In the upper little bitty top of the command module, right? And behind them was the lunar that's it. That's the rocket equation manifest large in the Saturn V. So weight matters. The reduction of weight matters. The shrinkage of electronics was an initiative brought about by NASA, not by anybody else. And then it became a huge boon to the electronics industry. Now miniaturization is standard fare. So, but that's not even the best reason. The best reasons are that new discoveries will be writ large every week in the newspapers. And you will see the causes and effects of innovation, of investments in science and technology while you're advancing a frontier. And I submit that we will transform the country into an innovation nation. So that whether or not it is the space frontier that attracts you, the fact that we are innovating will make it manifest right as bright as day that if you don't embrace those activities, your economy has nothing to grow on. So NASA becomes a flywheel of inspiration and innovation that drives a nation forward in an economy right now that is basically in the toilets.
Yeah. Well, I understand that.
That was a long answer. I'm sorry, but that's the whole beginning, middle, and end of it.
Well, and I'm sure, too, that having to try and communicate all of that, especially considering that a lot of the things you're talking about are long-term effects, I would imagine that that makes it all the more difficult to try and raise funds from the United States government because a lot of times they don't necessarily look towards the most long-term goals.
Yeah, I would say most times. In fact, 88% of Congress is up for election every 2 years. So they've got a two-year horizon. Corporations have a quarterly report, at most an annual report horizon. They might have some R&D where they're thinking a couple of years out, but not 5 years out, not 10 years out. And so this money for NASA would not be a handout, as many people now think of NASA money. They say, oh, we can't afford NASA now. Come back to us when our pockets are flush. No, that's the wrong approach. They have to recognize that NASA is an investment in our economic strength. At that point, you just become investors. And if you're investing, then it's the state of the economy is irrelevant. You want to make money tomorrow that you didn't have today, you invest. Doubling NASA's budget is an investment in us all.
And do you think that it helps at all that we have Obama as a president rather than, let's say, as we had George W. Bush, just on the simple basis that at least Obama accepts the scientific truths about what we know right now, or at least at that point?
It's an interesting question. The entire first chapter of my recent book, Space Chronicles, is called Space Politics. And in it, I took off the gloves and I'm bare-fisted in there, just citing cases where people's political leanings completely clouded their capacity to interpret information. So, yes, Obama is more scientifically literate than George W. Bush. There's no question about it. In Washington, however, it's not relevant to most things. What is relevant is, what is the budget that you have allocated to one agency versus another? That's all that matters in Washington. The rest is rhetoric. Yes, the rest can influence people's feelings and could provide top cover for certain movements, certainly. But what I care about is, where have you put your money? All right, now here's what happened. Under Bush, Bush says, let's go back to the moon, onto Mars, and beyond. That was a completely sound, sensible plan at the time. This was in 2004, after we lost the Columbia space shuttle. So it was said, well, what are we doing? Let's rethink this. I was on a commission that he appointed to establish NASA's future. It was completely sound. We would phase out the shuttle, because the shuttle was dangerous. We just lost a shuttle, right? We'd phase it out, use this money saved to bring in a new set of launch vehicles that would get us back to the moon, Mars, and beyond. This would be within budget, small upticks over the few years, but it would be within budget, and it would get us back on track. All right. We would learn in the Bush administration that you need almost all the money to launch your last shuttle as you did to launch your first shuttle, and you can't just phase out shuttle money while you're still flying shuttles. So while we were phasing out the shuttle, there was not the commensurate savings from having done so. So NASA really needed an uptick in its budget. So Bush did not give political background, a political backup to that need. And so NASA's budget went up just a few percent, but not the amount necessary. Meanwhile, the shuttle is still on a trajectory for being shut down. Obama now takes office. He continues with the shutdown trajectory. Now the Republicans are blaming him for shutting down the shuttle.
Right.
When, of course, that was put into effect under Bush. But since a Republican and a Democrat have to fight each other, even when they agree...
which can actually happen now and again. Yeah,
because that is, they can violently agree with each other, but it looks like they're disagreeing.
Right.
But because it has to be that way, because Bush was so vilified by Democrats, almost to the level that Obama is vilified by Republicans who resent him. And there's NASA caught up in the middle of this. NASA has historically been political. It just hasn't been partisan. I don't mind politics. That is Washington. Politics. I don't have an issue. It's when it becomes partisan that you lose the support that NASA had always enjoyed, that NASA never had to worry about. It's hard enough getting NASA funding. Now we have to wade through partisan politics to do so. And so the shuttle ends and the Republican-led resistance blamed Obama for killing our future in space. Meanwhile, Obama made plans to continue on to Mars. That this gets lost in the conversation. The difference is, Obama says, let's go to Mars, well, when? Mid-2030s. But let's do the research and develop the corporate partnerships and the new launch vehicles necessary to accomplish that. Well, what happens between now and then? Well, we're not going into space. So there is a gap. My worry is that Obama promised that we'll go to Mars at a time that will unfold under a president to be named later on a budget not yet established. So what does it mean for a president to promise that something that's going to happen in 20 years? When in 20 years he's on a beach in Hawaii then, all right? In Kennedy's day, he said, let's go to the moon before the decade is out. That's basically under his watch. He could promise something that his political capital could invest in and sustain while he was president. And yes, he got assassinated, so it fell to the vice president.
Right.
But the idea is that was a day when a president could promise something that they would see to completion under their own watch.
Do you think that Obama is saying this because he is under the impression that it will in fact take that long, that we're not necessarily at the capability yet in science in order to get to Mars at this point? Or do you think there's
two
something
things.
Else?
That's an excellent question. There are two things. There's budget and there's money. And they okay. one they equal each other. Okay, they're sort of inverse. Sorry, did I say budget? I didn't mean
budget
sorry.
And money.
Sorry,
yeah.
sorry. Budget and timetable.
Ah,
okay. Sorry.
There
okay,
we go. Thanks. It's yeah. It's hot in here. I understand.
Let the listener know that Matthew looked at me curiously as I said two things: budget and money. So thanks for paying close attention to the words
You're
that
welcome.
Come out of my mouth. So there's budget and there's schedule, and if you're not going to get to Mars for 2030. That's because you have decided that your budget doesn't need to be high enough to get to Mars sooner than that. So if you up the budget, then Mars becomes a nearer-term target rather than a longer-term target. Yes, we have to discover new things. Yes, we have to invent things. Yes, we have to figure out how to survive the radiation dose the astronauts are going to get from Mars. Yes, our propulsion still sucks. Yes, but these are – no one's saying that's impossible. You know, if you put out a call – to engineers to solve these problems, and we have a program commensurate funded to those ambitions, those problems get solved. I have no doubt about it. But to put it in 2035, that's on a budget that's not, you have not put into place to inspire people. That's one that just pedals along, keeps people employed. So I fault the Bush administration, and I'm partly to blame for this because I was on a committee that projected the future of NASA, for not seeing that you needed all the money to launch the last shuttle than you did to launch the first shuttle, preventing extra monies from coming in. I fault the Bush administration for not supporting that plan, that Moon, Mars, and Beyond plan, with more political capital than he did. I fault Obama for saying, oh, we don't need to go to the moon. We've been there already. Sounds great in a speech. Let's just go straight to Mars. Sounds great, but then we're not going to be on Mars in 20 years. What happens to the entire launch, the intellectual capital that you had, who were busy understanding what it takes to get into orbit in the first place and what to go, the rocket launch expertise that is there now that all been laid off because we haven't been going anywhere. We're hitching a ride with the Russians to get to our own space station. That's a little, I don't mind that, but it's embarrassing. Okay.
Right.
And we're paying, I forgot what the latest figure, 20 million, 30 million, 40, it's some, a big chunk of change. By the way, that says we're not hitching a ride, because when you hitch a ride, you ride for free.
We're paying for the privilege.
This is where we got the billet of transfer there. We're paying our way. So that's a little embarrassing. So here we have this, and I don't think it has anything to do with partisan politics. It just has to do with foresight and insight into what's best for the nation.
Do you think that a lot of private corporations will be really interested or excited about being able to do something like go to Mars? Wouldn't that be a really cool thing that a corporation could latch itself onto?
Yeah, that'll never happen.
It won't happen. How? No. Why do you think that?
Yeah, and I said that, and people all over the internet saying, well, you don't know what you're talking about. The history of private enterprises, you know, they just, a whole lot of hot air came out of that when I made that comment. And I'm intrigued when people just assert that I'm completely clueless. I'm enchanted by that. People, it's as though I'd not really thought this through.
Right.
Right. And maybe I didn't. I'm not saying I know everything or I've really thought as deeply as perhaps others have. But at least pause before you jump to these conclusions. And let me remind you, the original title of my book, the current title, the title that it got published as, was Space Chronicles, Facing the Ultimate Frontier. But that's not the title I submitted it with. The submitted title was Failure to Launch, the Dreams and Delusions of Space Enthusiasts. Because so much of the book is highlighting why the space enthusiast kept getting it wrong. Why they said, we'll be in Mars by 1985, after they saw we were on the moon in 1969. No, you got that wrong, and here's why. All right, and you could have figured this out at the time. It's not just a retrospective why. It is understood why. Okay, so here's why private enterprise will never lead a space frontier. It's because a space frontier is expensive, it is dangerous, and the risks are unquantified. When you combine all three of those, you cannot establish a capital market valuation of that activity. So therefore, there are no investors, because there's no one that can tell you what your return on that investment will be. So the first entities to advance big, expensive, dangerous, unknown risk frontiers are governments. That's how it's always been. First Europeans to the New World were not the Dutch East India Trading Company. It was Columbus. It was Magellan. It was, you just go down the list. That whole first flotilla of explorers were all paid by governments. Once the trade winds were mapped and the currents were established and the friendlies and the hostiles were identified and the food sources, then commercial enterprise comes in. That's how it's always been. This is where Gingrich got it wrong. He said, well, I want to do with space what the railroads did with the country. They had private enterprise. Well, excuse me, somebody had to, like, own the land first.
Right. Somebody had to, skipping a step.
You skipped an important step there. Somebody, like, with the names of Lewis and Clark had to, like, right, map the place. All right? So before you're quick to jump to, like, corporate savior mode, understand the history of this exercise. So once we go to Mars and we draw the maps, and once we do these things and the patents are awarded and routes are established, then you expect, I would fully welcome private enterprise to come in and take over these routine operations. SpaceX, everyone was happy when SpaceX docked with the space station. I'm saying that should have happened 20 years ago. Oh, it's the beginning of a new era. What an accomplishment. It's a spacecraft docking with the space station. That's already happened hundreds of times, all right? So that's not a space frontier that just got breached. Right. No, that's somebody docking that happened to be private. So it was a cultural frontier that was breached, not a space frontier. The cultural frontier is we will finally allow a private enterprise to dock with NASA, all right? That was portrayed in 2001, A Space Odyssey. It was all private. It was a Pan Am shuttle docking with a space station that had AT&T phones and Howard Johnson restaurants on it. Mm. All right. And so it was a little bit of commercial future that they were trying to imagine for you or help you imagine. So, private enterprise will come in whatever way they can make a dollar. I don't have any problems with any of that. Some of it will be touristic. Some could be mining operations. There's no limit of natural resources in space. Some of it might be for security reasons. Maybe that asteroid is headed our way, and I don't want to learn how to deflect it. Let me put that on the list of things to do,
important.
Your to-do list. And maybe there's a military reason. Maybe the military has reasons why they want to go into space, scientific reasons. All of these would be legitimate reasons to go into space, and we would do it all at the 1% of the federal tax budget money.
We're not doing it.
No, we're not. And so basically America is sliding backwards, even by standing still, in the face of investments made by other nations in the world. It's that simple.
For those of you just tuning in, I am Matthew LaClair, and this is Equal Time for Freethought on WBAI 99.5 FM. And my guest today is Neil deGrasse Tyson. Do you think that the effectiveness of communication about this will eventually turn the tide, so to speak, in terms of the federal government? Or is it perhaps, is it something that needs to be a more public push?
That's a hard question. And, you know, I'm just groping in the dark here. When the book came out, I was called to testify in front of the Senate. And I don't like talking to politicians because I'm an educator and I'm a scientist, and I'd rather compel the electorate to compel their leaders. If you convince a leader, then what happens 2 years later when they're elected out of office? Now you got to go back to the next leader. The strongest way to make this happen is to have the public want it. If the public wants it, then their elected officials become unelected for not following their wishes. That's in the ideal case, that's how that should work. But I saw that C-SPAN was not going to be at the testimony because I wanted to really testify to the American people, not to the Senate. But then there was a camera there, and it turns out they film everything. And it got posted on YouTube.
It's on YouTube, yeah.
It went on YouTube. And so it got several hundred thousand views within a few weeks. And just a few days ago, words from those testimony have been, you know, a videographer has put beautiful images to those words. And now using the sounds plus the visuals, this message is reaching people in ways I had not imagined or I had not forecast, I guess is what I should say. But I'm happy because I don't want people to do it because I said so. I want people to do it because I made a case that they agree with and that they take ownership of that case. And that way they are making the argument. They're not just peddling my arguments.
Is that what Cosmos is going to try and accomplish?
Thanks for bringing that up. Cosmos, the original Cosmos, at its best, wasn't the recitation of science, although that was a big part of Cosmos. Cosmos, at its best, was conveying to you how important science is as a citizen of the world, how important science needs to be to you so that you can be a participating member of a democratic society and possibly as a leader in where we take this world next. And the role that science plays in that, I don't think was previously embraced before Cosmos first aired. I think science was just a thing. It was like basket weaving. I can learn it or choose not to, but it won't make any difference to me. It's just a choice. They're basket weavers and they're scientists. Cosmos allowed people to embrace the scientific method, what science is all about, what scientific discovery means, not only intellectually, but culturally, even spiritually. I use spiritually not in reference to woodland spirits, but just in terms of how you feel, just in terms of your sense of understanding of your place in the universe. That's what Cosmos did, and at its best. And our goal going forward is to make sure that in the 21st century, we know how to tell that story to this new audience on a network where a bad day for Fox is 10 times the audience of PBS. I don't know if those numbers are exactly right, but the sense of it is correct. So there's no greater crossroads of television watching than what exists in the Fox portfolio. You have the conservative banter that goes on Fox News. You have
that was a good way of
Fox trying to be
good
polite
way of
putting
here. It, yes,
you've got the Fox Sports, it's respected all the world around. Right. You have Fox Business News. You have Fox. Just normal Fox television, which has the left-wing acerbic commentary that you'd find in Family Guy and in The Simpsons. So it's got left-wing and right-wing. It's got the number one show on television or among the number one shows on television in American Idol. So at Fox's 20th Century Fox that brought you Avatar, Fox's Foxlight Pictures, the indie arm that brought you Slumdog Millionaire and Little Miss Sunshine. So Fox is a huge conglomerate, and it's the right place. And that relationship was brokered by Seth MacFarlane, who I became fast friends with after I met him at a kickoff meeting for the Science Entertainment Exchange, a new office of the National Academy of Sciences that is based in essentially Hollywood, California, which serves as a reference for writers, not actors, but writers, producers, directors, to encourage them to embrace scientific themes in their storytelling. So it's not, oh, did I get the right species of creature in this scene at this time of year, this part of the world? Yes, that's available for that as well. But have you considered making one of your characters a scientist? Or one of your lead, protagonist, an engineer? Just things, you know, I'm tired of the doctor, lawyer, you know, Indian chief model, where we just put in the same tired old professions. Let's be a little more imaginative here. And in that way, science can be mainstreamed, as I think it needs to be, because the world of science is itself all around us. And until it's mainstreamed, I think people will neither know this nor embrace it.
And I understand that in the Cosmos series, I actually have the DVD set at home. I've been able to see all the episodes, which is nice.
When the DVD was released, a lot of the older images from Voyager of the planets were swapped out with Hubble images.
Hmm.
So that gave it a fresh look going into the next generation.
Right, constantly changing. Yeah.
But the narration was the same, but just what Carl was describing, it just had a more updated image for it.
Yeah, and in that series, I remember obviously they talk about space and the issues surrounding physics just a little bit. But I also noticed that he would talk about things like, you know, the age of the planet and things like, occasionally evolutionary theory, topics of that sort. Will these be the kinds of issues that you'll be addressing in the series, or will it be more out there type of
science?
Is it
in here or out there? Actually, there's a place where he's reviewing the shell of a crab off the coast of Japan, where it looks like a samurai warrior face. And it has been rumored that over the millennia of fishing, that if you caught a crab that looked like one of these warriors, you threw it back. And so then the ones that would reproduce that form of their back were other samurai faced crab shells. And so you can actually create a kind of artificial selection. So Carl, he said bluntly and straight to the camera, evolution is a fact.
That was pretty good. You must have watched it.
And so my preferred style, if I call it that, and I think it characterized most of Cosmos, is just to offer the universe in all of its glory and all of its majesty and train people how to think. And once you do that, they'll arrive at their own conclusions. And some conclusions that they may have previously had would be untenable or essentially impossible to sustain in the face of learning how to think. As an educator, I'd rather not shove something in somebody's face. I'd rather put it out there as an offering and let them explore it and come to the conclusions themselves.
That's one thing I was really curious about in terms of your development to getting to the point of being a science educator. When you started as being involved in astrophysics, that was your interest.
Oh, yeah, of course. It still is.
At what point did it turn from that particular focus sort of in closed doors, in sort of private
lab work, yeah.
to becoming more of a direct science educator to the public?
Well, if I had my way, I would give it all up and go back and become a scientist, right? And
you love
so that. Oh, yeah. I much prefer that to everything else I'm doing now. But I'm not so naive as to think that I shouldn't do at least some of what I'm doing now. But at the moment, I'm doing a lot of public work. There's the book. I have a lecture series that just came out. And the title is, I'm proud of it, actually. The title is called The Inexplicable Universe. It's six classes that I taught on all the stuff that continues to stump the astrophysicist on the frontier.
How long is this going to be?
Well, what's funny is since we're stumped, the lectures are pretty easy to give. Dark matter, right. We have no idea what that is. Next topic.
Next. Yeah.
Dark energy, we have no idea what that is. So that comes out, and there's the Cosmos. I have a radio show called Star Talk Radio, where I'm the host. I'm the scientist, but my guests are pop culture people, and then I explore how science has impacted their lives and livelihood. You combine all of this, there's a lot of sort of public activities there. The radio show and the Cosmos were unique opportunities where I felt I would be irresponsible if I did not avail myself of them. So all that began when people started coming back to me. I would explain something. They'd say, oh, I want more of that. People meaning media. I'd give a soundbite that they liked, and something the universe would flinch the next month. I'd come back, you got another soundbite for us again? And so I would work on that. People said, oh, you're so natural on Jon Stewart. You have no effing idea what I put in before every interview with Jon Stewart and Stephen Colbert. I'm laden with the previous news cycles of current events, and I explore in my own head how they might connect one piece of information to another, one bit of current events to the science, one bit of science to the science itself. And I'm mixed in this maelstrom as the comedic lines fly, and I've got to hold my own, be coherent, but still be fun. This is a huge burden to someone just sitting there being interviewed, and I work on that. This is not, it's not something natural. I'm happy it looks natural.
Right.
That's what
that's
I feel about
part.
It. But in fact, I'll take it as a compliment, but it was not without serious investment. I timed how long, what the average interval was between when Jon Stewart interrupts you with a joke. And I said, if that's the average interval and I have a point to make, I'm going to make it in less time than that interval. So that when he makes the joke is on a completed thought. And then when I come back, there's a completed thought, a completed joke, and now I can respond to a complete thing.
Right.
But if I'm fragmentarily interrupted because I'm just dragging on, now I hadn't even made my point yet. And then I'm fighting with his joke to try to make the point, and then it becomes a contest rather than a mutually supportive tennis match.
And I'm sure it's a little bit...
Volleys.
It always seems like it would be a little bit harder to have to respond to Stephen Colbert than Jon Stewart.
Yes.
Just because of the...
Stephen Colbert is by far my hardest interview.
He's, I figured,
far beyond. And a distant second is Jon Stewart, and everybody else is a distant third. So I do this, and I'm charmed that people come back for more. And I do that, and I offer it willingly. But at the end of the day, I still think of myself as a servant of the public appetite for the universe. And I'm happy to report that that appetite is high, but I don't really seek it out. I really don't. Of the times I'm on television, being interviewed for one reason or another, 85% of them are because the universe flinched and I got a phone call. If I happen to have a book, we announced the book during the interview, but the book wasn't what drove it. The book wasn't what created that interview. 15% of the time, I have a project, and then they're marketing people, and they shoehorn me into somebody's talk show list. That's 15% of the time. So I'm happy to say that most of the time, it's pure curiosity by the gatekeepers of news. I'm very happy to announce that. And the 15%, that just, you know, that pays the rent, I guess. You know,
right.
That's because we're selling. I'm trying to sell you a book. I'm selling you the lecture series. The rest of it is just the public being hungry.
And do you have any time left over to do any of the lab work?
Yeah, right now there's like maybe 8 neurons that I'm devoting to that right now.
Gotcha.
I'm not going to bring it back to the trillion that it needs to be. I hope after Cosmos is done, and I have a couple other books that may come out between now and then, that I can then start changing the balance of the public exposure to my time in the lab. That's my goal, however delusional I am for having it. That's my story, and I'm sticking to
it. In terms of trying to make sure that the public understands some basic scientific knowledge, as well as the some of the intricacies as well, there was I don't know if I would call it a news story or a happening. I guess I'll call it a happening, where there was some incident with you and James Cameron and Titanic. And
it was an incident, yes.
I looked at those three things together, and I was scratching my head.
Like, what is the common denominator here? Yeah, he got the wrong sky over the sinking Titanic. We know the date, the time, the year, the longitude, the latitude. We know enough about how, when, and where the Titanic sank, and we know it was a cloudless, moonless night, that there's only one sky that should have been above Kate Winslet as she's singing deliriously to the night sky, and he got the wrong sky. In fact, it wasn't even the wrong sky. The left side of that sky was a mirror reflection of the right side of the sky.
Oh,
so it was not only wrong, it was lazy.
Mm.
And I wrote him a letter on my finest stationery, never got a reply. Then I finally met up with him. I told him about this. And he said, well, that happened in post-production. So he kind of, you know, put a little distance between him, he, the director, and the post-producers. And I wasn't satisfied. I want him to grovel at my feet begging for forgiveness. So a third time I would see him, I mentioned it again. And he said, I'm having dinner with him and wine is pouring. And there's eight of us at the table. So I'm as an immature little... I bring it up again. I'm still waiting for him to grovel. And he said, well, last I checked, Titanic grossed more than $1 billion worldwide. Imagine how much more it would have earned had I gotten the sky correct. Ooh. Whoa, there it is. Just totally called me out. So I said, I'll just shut up from now on. All right. And a month later, I got a phone call from his post-producer who said, Mr. Cameron is putting together a 10-year director's cut version of his movie. He's adding some footage to that, and he tells me he has a sky he can use. So I say, yo!
Oh, man.
Yo! So he came through. Turns out I never saw the 10-year director's cut because that was in 2006. I don't know if it was ever made, but he did come out with the release, the 3D release for the centennial anniversary. And in that, by the way, I was on YouTube saying this, in very quite passionately, I would add, he would then succumb to this pressure and say, yes, we actually did reshoot parts of the film, including the scene above Kate Winslet at the scene. I think that's the most important sky there ever was. The sky at the zenith above her head at the scene of the sunken ship. They refilmed it with the sky that I provided. And so he retold it in the news article in a way that was not strictly accurate, but it was, the sense of it was completely correct. He said, you know, he called me or sent me letters, and he sent me annoying letters. I'm paraphrasing, right? And he said, so I finally did it, you know, that son of a bitch.
Get him off my back.
Yeah, get the son of a bitch off my back. Right. So some of the news articles didn't reproduce the son of a bitch part.
I
took it as a token of affection, right? I mean, if he really didn't like me, he wouldn't have done it at all. Right?
Yeah.
So it's all right, you got me, you son of a bitch.
Well, and I understand, too, that Cameron was sort of respected in that particular film for trying to get accuracy.
I would not have held him to task if he made no other claims of accuracy in the film. I don't chase down all the inaccurate scenes in films.
Right.
What kind of life would that be?
Science fiction would be a real, real challenge, I'm
right,
sure.
Right, right. And how about all the sound in space and Star Wars, right? You can't do that.
Yeah.
But he marketed that film based on accuracy and precision that he had gleaned from his submersible to the Titanic. And he saw what the staterooms look like and the wall sconces and the china patterns and all that got captured in the film. And to do that and not get the correct sky, when anyone can double check that if you have a $50 planetarium program on your computer. So that's why I took him to task, because I thought he was sort of, quote, man enough to receive the criticism and possibly do something about it, which in fact he was and which in fact he did.
Were you actually sitting...
Oh, wait. Yeah, so his account was a very reduced version of what had actually happened, but it captured the right sense of it, that I was just some annoying little thing that he finally just said, how do I get him off my back, that son of a bitch? Let me just fix it. That'll shut it up. That I accept that digested version of the story, but the actual story is, as I've said it on just now, but also there's a YouTube clip of me conveying it.
Well, I'm just wondering if you were sitting down watching this film and you looked at the sky and you automatically noticed it was wrong.
Oh yeah.
It seems
Did
kind
I say
of
I was doing this since
people.
Age 9?
Right.
What part of that sentence didn't you understand? For those who just joined us, we let off with Dr. Tyson saying he's thinking about the universe since age 9.
Since age 9.
Yeah, so I know the sky. I mean, they're friends of mine, amateur astronomers who know the sky better than I do. But I know it pretty well for a professional. Many professionals came to it later, and they weren't doing it as a kid. We didn't have a backyard telescope. So I'm card-carrying from the amateur astronomy days. And amateur astronomers know the night sky like they know the back of their hand.
A lot of people seem just shocked that a person would be able just to look at an image, knowing where the general image is taken and then look at it and just say, "Oh, that's not the
right
sky."
Wait a minute. If you walk into your living room and the couch was in a different place, would you notice that? I think so. If you go into your bedroom and the bed is like against the wall instead, you would notice this. So my night sky
is your living room.
Our night sky is not so much your living room, because you're in your living room every day, but it's your backyard. Did someone rearrange the lawn furniture? To me, the night sky is my backyard, and he rearranged the lawn furniture. No, in fact, he invented a kind of lawn furniture that didn't even exist.
Or he took half of a lawn chair and then cut it up and then pasted the other side.
Now, this is a little bit of inside baseball here, but the leading amateur astronomers magazine called Sky and Telescope, after Titanic aired, reported that he got this sky correct. And they just got it wrong. Here's what happened. There is a constellation that's a horseshoe shaped, where the stars on one side of the horseshoe resemble the stars on the other side. They're not exactly resemble, but you can, and it's called a corona borealis. It's actually a crown, corona. It's a in constellation illustration, it would be represented as a crown. And so they said, oh, he got that right. Remember, he advertised that everything was accurate in this film. So this little ditty in Sky and Telescope magazine said, look, the movie's so accurate, he even got the sky correct. Okay? And I said, oh, all right, I'm going to double check this. Because I read it doesn't mean I think it's true. And I saw it, and I saw the horseshoe pattern, but it was an exact mirror reflection. And if you exact mirror reflect any arc of stars, it makes a horseshoe. And so, no, he got it wrong.
Oh.
So wrong.
Oh, that's unfortunate for him. that's what I love.
No, he's an explorer. Yeah. I mean, I look at his profile, he's the genuine article. And so he's famous and rich and influential. So that gives you some latitude to poke at him, right? But he poked back at me, too. And I think my ego could handle it.
It's always a fun exchange, yeah. One thing I remember you talking about back when I first met you in 2007 was...
Back when you were six?
At a one in front of that, and then you got the got
okay,
it exactly.
Fine.
16. And I remember you were talking about interactions that you had with Carl Sagan.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, I mean, I spent... I was not like beer drinking buddies with Carl Sagan. First,
right.
We're a generation apart. And plus, I knew I was interested in the universe before I knew anything of him. So I can't credit him with sparking that interest within me. But I can credit him with another very important dimension of who and what I am. He invited me to Cornell my senior year of high school. He had been notified of my application, I presume by the admissions office. My application had the universe dripping all over it because I knew what I wanted in life.
Right.
So there I am. He gets the application. He sends me a personal letter signed by him saying, notice you'd like the universe. Once you come up, I'll show you around Cornell to help you decide what college you want to go to. I said, was this the Carl Sagan? He'd already been on The Tonight Show. He'd already had famous books. And turns out, yes, it was really Carl Sagan. Yes, I did take a bus and go from New York to Ithaca, New York City to Ithaca. He met me outside of his building. It was on a Saturday, so campus was empty. Saturday during a Christmas break, actually. It was late in December, so no one was on campus. He meets me, takes me up to his office, reaches behind and pulls out a book. This is the coolest thing. Didn't even look. Just reaches behind and pulls out a book, signed. It's one of his books. He signs it, gives it to me. I still have that book. And it started to snow a little bit. I was ready to head back home. It's winter in Ithaca. Yes, it snows. And he said, I don't know, if the snow picks up and gets heavy and the bus can't get through, then here. He wrote down his phone number and said, bus may have, can't get through, call me, spend the night, leave tomorrow. And I'm thinking, who am I? I'm just some kid. I'm just some high school kid. And from that day onward, I said to myself, if I am ever as remotely as famous as Carl Sagan, then I will give time to students the way he has given time to me. And it's not a prerequisite whether I know them, whether they're my best friend's kids, whether the parent thinks their kids are smart. I don't care. If you're a student, you're going to get my time. And you got my time. I mean, you were 16. I thought you were six, but okay, you're
right.
16.
Close enough.
I'm here with you now, right? I mean, so I take it seriously. It changed. I don't know what I would have been without that encounter, but I certainly know what I became with that encounter. And it's someone who sees that I'm just part of a huge wheel that we're all just trying to turn, and other people are climbing onto that wheel, and it's my duty and obligation to keep that wheel turning.
And it's wonderful to be able to talk to you and watch you, especially looking forward to the Cosmos series. I think that's going to be really exciting.
That's spring 2014. All over the internet it says 2013, but it's 2014.
And I think people must just be getting a little bit overexcited.
They're trying to will it into the nearer future.
Will it into existence, actually. It's close enough.
No, it takes a lot of work, and it's a full 13 episodes. That's why. It's not just a one-off.
And have you started filming
yet?
We're
scripting now. We start filming in the fall.
Very cool.
Yeah, production. There's pre-production, then production, then post-production, and so spring 2014.
Are you worried that it'll be too funny with you and Seth MacFarlane working together in tandem?
Okay,
on
so
this,
a couple of things.
Yeah.
Very important question. So two things. First, we all know Seth MacFarlane is a funny guy, right?
Right.
He has very serious science interests, and if you look at Family Guy, science shows up thematically often. Typically through the world of Stewie, because Stewie invents a time machine. In fact, there was one episode where Seth had come through New York and said, Neil, you want to have lunch? I said, sure, we go have lunch. And he asked me 20 questions about the early universe and the Big Bang and the cosmic microwave background. And then, like, 4 months later, there's a whole episode with Stewie and his time machine going back to the Big Bang. And then there's, like, a whole screen of my name on it saying, science consultant. What it should have said, to be accurate, right. My lunch with Neil Tyson, right? That's what it really was. So he cares, and he likes having fun with it. Now, he's not scripting this. He's not telling us what themes to write. We have others, myself and the two writers of record, Steve Soder and Andrian. They both were co-writers of the original Cosmos. So they have a genetic link to the original. And I'm the add-on at this point, right? Carrying the soul of Carl forward. So Seth is there as our interface with Fox, because all his work is with Fox, and he's highly contracted with Fox. Now, that being said, a lot of what I do publicly carries humor with it. Primarily because I think the universe is hilarious, okay? So, and much of the original Cosmos had a certain gravitas because Carl Sagan would look upon the cosmos and there'd be billions of stars. And consider, you know, I mean, just his very delivery and his, like I said, that's the word, the gravitas with which he communicated ideas and phrases and words with the audience is something I don't know that I have. I can speak that way, no doubt about it, but it's not how I always speak, and it's not how I've forged what it is in the ways that people know me. If you look at any YouTube clips that people post, oh, by the way, I don't post any, I don't even know how to post a YouTube clip. They're all posted by people who care.
Right.
In ways that I'm flattered that they care. They smuggle in a, you know, camcorder in one of my talks, and they post like a 3-minute ditty from my talk.
And then let's not even get into the memes that are created.
Oh,
from the
memes.
Images.
Yeah, the memes is a whole other place to go.
Right.
But what's interesting is because YouTube's medium is a 1 to 4 minute construct, what it means is all the clips of me giving talks, it's like the best of. No one's going to post a 2-minute clip of me being boring.
Right.
Why post that? You leave that. No, it's just not there. So there's a slightly false sense that I'm completely hilarious all the time. If these are the clips that mattered most to people that they posted, I think I could be just a regular guy just trying to teach content for at least half of these talks of which these clips are selected. But nonetheless, there's a certain access to humor that I like having. I think people learn better when they smile. I think they remember better when they're happy. And so we are now working on, I'm not going to try to be Carl Sagan because I'll just fail because we're different people. So I'd rather be a successful Neil Tyson than a failed Carl Sagan. And I don't want to be a successful Carl Sagan. Carl is Carl. Let that be what it is. It's a time for me to be what I am, and let that be what it is. Was that sentence literate at all?
I think we understood it, though.
Yeah, it was understandable, however illiterate it came out of my mouth turned out to be.
So. Yeah, well, at least when things are scripted, you won't have to worry about that too much. But, you know, I think to the humor point, I think it's a very effective tool that I think will really work, especially trying to communicate science to a general public. I always got the impression that that's why teenagers, for example, would gravitate so much to you in trying to learn science.
Oh, it's a huge following. I mean, I can tell from my Twitter stream. I tweet at Neil Tyson, by the way. NEILTYSON. I can just tell by the Twitter stream, there's a huge sort of fan base, if I can call it that, in high school, not quite middle school, but certainly high school, definitely college, and folks who have recently graduated who are trying to sort of get their first job, but they still embrace science. Science is not something they ever feared. They came to like it and not have a crappy science teacher turn them off from it. They knew that science was cool. They just happened to have a crappy science teacher. And so that's an important place to be, because that's a whole generation of people coming up in the ranks that could transform this world simply because they embrace science, whether or not they became scientists themselves. There's no reason to fear whether Stewie's going to pop up in the middle of some deep thought in the cosmos.
Right.
But nothing to stop Stewie from commenting on cosmos in the heavy cross-marketing that Fox always does for its own product. That could be fun to see how they respond. You know what
Ooh,
I really
this,
want?
This sounds exciting.
You know what I really want? Here's a commercial I want to have. You know, during the Super Bowl, the Fox always talks about its own shows rather than sell that ad time to commercials. And so here's something cool. You get the two quarterbacks for the opposing teams, okay? Everyone's out in the field ready for the coin toss for the Super Bowl, right? And where are the quarterbacks? Can anybody find the quarterback? So the camera goes in through the tunnel, and there they are sitting next to each other watching TV. You just see the back of the TV, and you see the front of them on a couch together. They say, we got this game together. Nope, it's going to have to wait. I'm watching Cosmos.
Oh, man. Yeah, I wonder what's going to happen during, you know, Super Bowl time right around there. It's going to be a little
rough, I should say, but it's a springtime show, and Fox has the Super Bowl, so it'd be fun to see how that all plays.
That's okay. Hopefully you'll get some advertisements even during Super Bowl. That would be
It'd be great. It'd be great. It'd be a tacit recognition that this matters.
And hopefully people get to latch onto that. Mm-hmm. Well, thanks very much for talking to me
today, Dr. Tyson.
Happy
to be on your show, my first time. I hope not the last.
Yeah, me either. We'll definitely have you on again sometime in the near future. And again, thanks very much.
Okay,
and
thanks.
And we'll talk again soon.
All right.
All right. If you missed any part of this program or would like to hear it again or share with friends, visit our website at equaltimeforfreethought.org. And remember to tune in, pay it forward, and question everything.
If you want to write a song about the moon, walk along the craters of the afternoon. When the shadows are deep and the light is alien, and gravity leaps like a knife off the pavement, and you want to write a song about the moon, you want to write a spiritual tune. The na 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 na, yeah, yeah, yeah. Presto, a song about the moon. If you want to write a song